Thank you, Hamid. I'm sorry that sort of went a little bit over time. I did try to stop her a few times. when we've asked our speakers to give a few recommendations after their presentations, and we hope with the recommendations that come through at the end of the day that we can make something tangible about that for the future. After I've introduced Rizwan and after he's spoken, there'll be a chance for questions on this section, which is about community issues. And we have questions after each section. I'd like to introduce you on my right here to Rizwan Hussain. Rizwan is a founding member of an organization called Jawab and Brent Against Racism Campaign. Jawab is an organization that raises awareness of social and political issues minority groups are facing. They want to challenge hate, racism, inequality, and injustice. They also want to break down negative misconceptions, stereotypes, preconceived notions about particular communities. They want to mobilize grassroots with the youth movement, offering them safe space for expression and giving them training so they can become future leaders. Also, as part of Brent Anti-Racist Campaign, which is a new broad-based group, which was set up recently to challenge racism in Brent. The group will take up issues in policing, housing, immigration, employment, education, and any other areas where racism becomes an issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, good evening everyone. I want to start off with a very short story of a young person that we're working with at the moment called Abdul. And Abdul is now 21 years old. We've been working with him for maybe a couple of years now around some of the issues around stop and searches and campaigning about some of the issues that he's affected by. And just to give you a bit of background about Abdul, he's 21 years old at the moment. He's grew up in a council estate. And his father left when he was quite young, and he's got siblings, and he's always felt the pressure to support his mother, and also the pressure of not asking too much from her. So he's had a few challenges growing up, and one of the major challenges that he faces on a regular basis is stop and searches, and a lot of his friends and his peers also are affected by stop and searches. So this has kind of created a bit of a tense atmosphere between the young people that are from the estate and also the police. So I was speaking to him last week, and he spoke about a particular incident that occurred when he was walking to the mosque. So he went into the mosque, and a police officer followed him into the mosque and stopped him and said, "You fit a racial profile of someone who attempted robbery in the morning, and we want to take you for questioning down at the police station." Now, for Abdul, it's pretty much a usual incident, like going to the police, being stopped and searched or questioned. So that wasn't the issue that he wanted to speak to me about. He was quite surprised that the space that was invaded, and that was his safe space almost, that he called it, which was the mosque. His faith, he believes, is pretty much a place of solace. It protects him from all the things that are going on outside. He talks about it's one constant in his life that he has. And I think also, in terms of Islam, it gives him a certain amount of protection, and also just some kind of role model. When you look at a revered prophet, like the prophet is quite in a high place, that he's, when he thinks about it, he's almost like a role model. So the chat extended to having distrust of the police and also politicians, and not being able to in any kind of way relate to them. We started talking about spaces, and what came out was that actually this was not the only space that was violated. It was if you went online, on social media, if you switched on the news, there was constantly this negative stories about Muslims and Islamophobia, and the whole narrative around that. When you would see images of suffering and violence across the Middle East, that was something that really made him question foreign policy. When he read about English Defence League or Pegida running marches, and he was also involved in going to these counter demonstrations, he felt that again there was another space that was being attacked. He's scared about his family, he's scared about his mother and his sisters because they wear the hijab, that, you know, they might be in any kind of way attacked on the street because he hears a lot about that. And I guess the thing that I wanted to come to was the safe space. And it seems like, talking to him, that a lot of his spaces are being violated and almost polluted with Islamophobia and racism. And I think this follows on to when I was coming off the tube the other day in Wilson, and I was given this leaflet, and I don't know if anyone has seen this leaflet. It was given by a police officer, and it said, "It's probably nothing, but if you see or hear something that could be terrorist related, trust your instincts and call the confidential terrorist hotline." And at the back it says something like, "Communities can defeat terrorism." Now this is exactly what fuels prejudice, it fuels discrimination, and with all the kind of aspects of all the stuff that's going around in different spaces, what happens is that Muslims are the suspect community, and especially young Muslims and young people. So I think in terms of spaces, another space being attacked or polluted as we talk about it. Now, when it comes to prevent and preventing schools, again, this is another space that is being invaded by, you know, some kind of like Islamophobia or kind of not racial profiling, but like profiling of young people and their faith and stigmatizing them. And what this creates is an alienation and marginalization from mainstream society. And that's what Abdul is facing, a lot of his peers are facing. So I think that prevent and talking to these young people has failed to win the hearts and minds of the community as it was intended to do. You know, it's under the guise of safeguarding. And what it does, it doesn't create any kind of opportunities where real discussions and critical debates can take place about foreign policy or about socio-economic issues that are affecting young people. So I think the challenge here is, and especially working with young people, I mean, last week I was talking to, I think it was about a group of 20 young people, and a lot of the issues that they were talking about, I mean, the top three were racism, discrimination, gangs, and negative stereotyping of young people. I didn't see anything about, you know, terrorism or ISIS or anything of that sort. And usually it's about mental health, unemployment. It's about issues that are affecting them on their daily lives. And I think that is something that we need to tackle, rather than looking at terrorism or radicalization as such. So very briefly, I mean, I'm at the end now. So my recommendations are that safe spaces should be created where young people can navigate offline and online, learn skills about developing themselves, developing how they can deal with these kind of tricky situations, how to deal with the police or maybe any kind of discrimination that they face on a daily basis, whether that's institutional or on the streets or verbal abuse or whatever. So we need to empower young people to become leaders, and that is exactly what Jawab is doing. And I think when it comes to schools, what has to happen is, yes, there should be safe spaces for like honest and open discussion and debate, but it cannot happen under the umbrella of prevent, for example. So it has to happen with charities or organizations that are autonomous and almost, you know, not in any kind of way controlled by prevent or under the watchful eye of prevent to create these safe spaces. And I think that is what we need to discuss. So going back to Abdul's first point is that he was saying that the prevent agenda is almost top heavy, like, you know, it's not really engaging with young people. There's nothing that, there's no way that he would engage with it. You know, he does not trust the state, he does not trust the police, so why would he then trust a policy that's created by people that he does not relate to? And I think that's the takeaway here. We need to be working with young people to shape and steer what is actually the issues that they're facing and how we can move to prevent. So, yeah, that's all I would like to say. Thank you.
We've got a little 5 minutes or so for questions, if anybody has any questions from the presentation so far. If you're going to make a comment, please make it a short comment, you know. So, questions.